since the past few weeks and the prayer. You might not mind doing it, but I definitely appreciate you being able to do that. And Peyton, thank you for singing. That was very beautiful. And Jane, Gray, Steve, all of you who always do things. It's so great to be a part of a place where people are actively serving, and I'm grateful to be able to serve alongside with you. As I mentioned, my grandfather preached his final sermon at Cornelia Christian Church last week. He'd been there over 50 years. It was just a neat experience. So many people who had been a part of that congregation over the years were there to support him. And I can honestly say that my granddad is probably the greatest person I've ever met. I don't think I've ever seen him sin or heard of him sinning. I know he would probably disagree with that. I think the closest that I've ever seen him sin was we were driving down the road one day. He was driving his little pickup truck, and this little field mouse ran out in front of us, and I feel him just press down on the gas like he's trying to hit it. I think that's the closest I ever got to see him do something bad. He was just, in my mind, he was a perfect man. And so last week, just being able to be there and listening to him share his thoughts. Of course, he told some stories from his experiences there. He shared some of the hopes and the dreams that he had had and how some of them were realized. But really, he used that sermon to encourage the congregation to continue focusing on the future and working ahead while it might be his final day there on staff. He knows that the church still has a bright future because of the people who are there. He told the story of the Last Supper when Jesus has gathered all of his disciples around him the night before his crucifixion. And he said that, this is kind of like that to me. This moment, my final day here, is kind of like that moment in the sense that Jesus knows he's not going to be with them anymore. And so he's trying to prepare his disciples for what they have to do. And Jesus knew that even recently they had still been arguing amongst themselves as to which was the greatest, which one was Jesus' favorite, which one was going to have the most authority under Jesus in his kingdom. And so my granddad said that this is kind of like that moment for me, because I know that I'm not going to be doing this anymore. But I want you to know that you still have work to do. And so he called up the elders and the deacons and Greg. Most of you probably remember Greg from our revival a few months ago. Greg is the man who's going to be replacing my granddad as the preacher there. And so he called them up and he said, it's always been in y'all's hands. We've always been doing this together. But now I'm not going to be doing this with you anymore. And he had them sit down. And just like Jesus washed his disciples' feet to say, a message to say, you are servants. You're not going to be rulers. If I could teach you anything, say one last thing to you, it's be a servant. He did the same for the elders and the deacons and to Greg. He asked them to take their socks and shoes off and sit down on the stage. And so they did. And he went one by one and washed their feet. And each one of them, he would say something, but he would always end with, "And I'm your servant. Thank you for letting me be your servant." And if I was Greg, I would be thinking, wow, this is what I have to follow. I'm someone who's not a preacher, who doesn't spend his time writing lessons and sermons and planning programs, but someone who serves people. And it's not always going to be fun or easy or clean, like, feet aren't clean. But, that's, to me, I think that we all kind of were touched by that we're servants. It was neat to see my grandfather not refer to himself as their preacher, their pastor, their leader, but as just a fellow servant with Christ. And I feel like that same kind of spirit is evident in the scripture that we're going to be looking at this morning. We're going to look at the book of Philemon. And Philemon is a very personal letter written by Paul, who is in prison. And he's writing to a man named Philemon, someone that he refers to as a fellow partner, a fellow servant of Christ, even a dear friend. And so let's begin in verse 1. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our dear friend and fellow worker, to Apphia, our sister — Apphia was most likely Philemon's wife — to Archippus, our fellow soldier — perhaps that was Philemon's and Apphia's child — and to the church that meets in your home. Philemon is a part of the Colossian church. If you read the letter to Colossians, you'll notice some similar names, and it seems likely that Philemon is a part of the Colossian church, that the church that meets in his home is probably the Colossian church. He continues, "Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints. I pray that you may be active in sharing your faith, so that you will have a full understanding of every good thing we have in Christ. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement, because you, brother, have refreshed the hearts of the saints." Now, wouldn't you just love to hear that said about you, especially by someone as revered as Paul, and that you have refreshed the hearts of the saints, that I remember you, I think about you constantly, and I pray for you constantly. And I hear, and I mean, other people are saying good things about Philemon too, because Paul, who is in prison, is being told things that Philemon has been doing. He says, "I hear about what you've been doing and your love and your great faith." And wouldn't you just love for someone to say that about you? And you can tell that Paul is very fond of Philemon, that they seem very close, that Paul loves Philemon. And he's saying all these nice things about him, but I also kind of get the sense that he's trying to butter up Philemon. He continues to say, "Therefore, although in Christ I could be bold and order you to do what you ought to do, yet I appeal to you on the basis of love. I then, as Paul, an old man, and now also a prisoner of Christ Jesus, I appeal to you for my son, Onesimus, who became my son while I was in chains. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he has become useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, who is my very heart, back to you. I would have liked to have kept him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while I'm in chains for the gospel. But I did not want to do anything without your consent, so that the favor you do will be spontaneous and not forced. Perhaps the reason he was separated from you for a little while was that you might have him back for good, no longer as a slave, but better than a slave, as a dear brother. He is very dear to me, but even dearer to you, both as a man and as a brother in the Lord." And so here's the purpose for the letter. Onesimus is a slave who belonged to Philemon. Philemon owned Onesimus. But it seems like Onesimus has run away, and somehow he's been introduced to Paul. And Paul introduces him to Christ, converts him. And so now Onesimus is a Christian, just like Philemon is a Christian. And so Paul is asking Philemon to welcome Onesimus back, to receive him back, not just as a slave, but also as a brother in Christ, a fellow partner and servant of the gospel. When we think of slavery, we probably think of American slavery. And while slavery in the first century in the Roman Empire had its similarities, it was also somewhat different. It said that as many as a third of the population of the Roman Empire would have been a slave at any given time during the first century, and that another third of the population had been a slave at one point. Many slaves were actually educated They were skilled and they were good at things. They weren't just people who couldn't take care of themselves or anything like that. They were educated a lot of the times, and so they would hire themselves out because being a slave provided a better economic plan for them. Masters owned their slaves. Technically, slaves were property. But most of the time, masters took good care of their slaves. They were sort of an investment. They would take care of them. And so if you were a slave, you knew that you were going to have a place to sleep that night. And you knew when you woke up in the morning, you would have breakfast. You knew you'd have food that day. You knew that your clothes would be provided for you and all your needs would be met. And so there were definitely some advantages to being a slave. Many slaves actually lived better than many free people did. And so a lot of times people would hire themselves as slaves for a period of time. They were kind of like bond servants or indentured servants in a sense. And so Onesimus is a slave to Philemon. And he runs away, and I get the sense that Philemon wasn't a cruel master. I'm sure there were cruel masters because slaves were property. They could be treated however a master wanted to treat them. As I mentioned, most of the time they were taken care of. But just based on what Paul writes, I don't think that Philemon was a cruel master at all. And that might speak a lot of the character of Onesimus. Maybe he was someone who was lazy or had a bad attitude, and while he had put himself in this situation to be a slave to Philemon, he realized he didn't want to do it anymore, so he just backs out on his end of the agreement and runs away. And somehow he meets Paul. We're not too sure how he meets Paul, but he does. And Paul changes his life, or Jesus changes his life. But as soon as Paul meets Onesimus, he knows, I know your master, and the Roman law requires me to send you back to him. Paul knows that he has to send Onesimus back to Philemon. Here's the thing, though. Runaway slaves could be punished by execution. I would think that Philemon's friends who have slaves would be whispering in his ear, if we ever find Onesimus, we need to kill him. We need to set an example for these slaves that if they're going to run away, they're going to be found and they're going to be punished with their lives. That's what Philemon would have been hearing. And Paul realizes this. And so he's kind of at this crossroads. What do I do with Onesimus? And so we see that Paul is making an appeal, a request to Philemon. Some will argue that he's using his authority as an apostle to kind of force or manipulate Philemon into doing something. Some kind of see his appeal based on pity. After all, he identifies himself as an old man and someone who's in chains. And if someone were to tell you that, I mean, how could you not do what they wanted? But the thing is, Paul is always proud of being a prisoner of the gospel. He's never ashamed of it. He's never complaining about being a prisoner. He's never upset and saying, I want to get out, or how can I get out, or this is miserable. Why did I choose this life? Paul's always proud of the fact that he's in prison for Jesus. And that word old man can also be translated as ambassador. And I think that Paul is proud that he is an ambassador for Christ, that he's in chains for the gospel. I mean, so I when I read this, I can see why people would think that. But I also get the sense that they're just friends. And Paul's writing to him as one friend to another. And so he knows that Philemon is his friend, but he has this new friend, Onesimus, too. And he's trying to figure out, what can I do? What do I do in this situation? He mentions that Onesimus was formerly useless to Philemon. Onesimus is actually translated as useful. And in that day, it was common for masters to give their slaves a name. And so maybe Philemon gives Onesimus his name, Useful, hoping that he'll live up to that name. And Paul says he didn't live up to that name formerly. He ran away. He wasn't useful to you. But now he can be useful to you, to me. He can be useful to everyone. And so he makes this request, and he continues in verse 17. So if you consider me a partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has done you any wrong or owes you anything, charge it to me. And this seems like Philemon may have even taken money, or Onesimus may have even taken money from Philemon, maybe to finance his escape. And so Paul's saying, I know that he took this money from you, but forgive him. And if it's a big deal, then I'll pay it myself. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will pay it back, not to mention that you owe me your very self. And that seems to indicate that Paul is responsible for Philemon becoming a Christian too, just like he's responsible for Onesimus becoming a Christian. And in a sense, that would make them, in Paul's mind, Paul views people like that as his sons, and that would make Philemon and Onesimus brothers. He says, I do wish, brother, that I may have some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. He's already written about how Philemon has refreshed so many other hearts. Paul's saying, refresh my heart too. Confident of your obedience, I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I ask. Paul's purpose in this letter is to ask Philemon to receive Onesimus back, to welcome him back. And in this, some see sarcasm, as if Paul's saying, not to mention, you owe me your very life. You owe me. Some see authority. I could be bold and command you to do this thing that you should do. Some see him as manipulating Philemon and trying to twist Philemon's arm. But I have the feeling that Philemon's standing there. I don't think anyone else is reading this letter. I know it's addressed to other people, but it just doesn't seem like something Paul would do to say, I want you to read this letter in front of everyone the first time you hear it. That way I know that there's going to be pressure on you. That just doesn't seem like Paul, especially after he was talking about that Philemon's love and the love that he has for him. I kind of think that Philemon's reading this, his eyes are pouring over the contents of this letter, and even though other people are with him, really the only person that he's thinking about right now is Paul. I mean, these two men are brothers. That's how they view themselves, brothers, partners. Two old men, in their old age, they've come to this realization that neither trying to make someone do something or ignoring what someone wants is going to accomplish any good, and it's especially not going to further the gospel of which they are both servants. And so I have this feeling that they're just, Paul doesn't know when he's reading this letter, the exact moment, but just I can picture them just staring at each other face to face and knowing that they're in this together and they both want to do the right thing. Oh man, I imagine that Paul agonized over this letter, over this situation, because Philemon is his friend. I mean, he wants to do right by Philemon, but he also loves Onesimus. And he knows there's a chance if Onesimus comes back that he could be punished. I don't know how severely, maybe even with his life. And I don't want that to happen to him, but I know the right thing is to send him back to Philemon. So I'm going to write this letter to him and just pour out my heart into this because I love them both. And I think that Paul gives Philemon a freedom of choice here, because he knows that Philemon is the kind of guy who's going to do the right thing. He's already mentioned how he knows that Philemon is the kind of guy who will do the right thing. And others have told him that Philemon is the kind of guy who will do the right thing. And he's seen it for himself. He knows that Philemon has the love of God in him. And it's love that gives people a choice and freedom. Love doesn't manipulate people or twist people's arms. Love gives people the choice. There's a story of President Thomas Jefferson who one day was riding horses with some of his friends, and they came upon a man who was wandering around in the woods. And as they were riding by him, he would look up at each person in Thomas Jefferson's company, and he'd look at their face, and they would keep riding by. And when the president was riding by, he said, "Sir, may I ride on your horse with you?" And Thomas Jefferson said, "Yes, of course." And he helps him up, and they're riding. And one of the men who's with them asks, "Why is it that you chose the President of the United States horse to ride on?" And the man said, "I didn't know that he was the president. All I know is that on the look of some people's face is no, and on the look of some people's face is yes. And on his face was yes." When Paul sees Philemon, he sees yes on Philemon's face. He sees a guy who's going to scoot over, who's going to maybe humble himself in order to help someone. Paul is confident in Philemon because Philemon has a yes face. And do we know what happened for sure? Did Philemon grant this request? There's nothing in the rest of Scripture that specifically tells us, but the fact that this letter was preserved, the fact that it was later included in Scripture, is a pretty good indication that Philemon said yes to Paul, that he welcomed Onesimus back, probably even more than a slave, not just as a slave, but as a brother, a friend, a partner in Christ. In verse 22, Paul says, "And one more thing, prepare a guest room for me, because I hope to be restored to you in answer to your prayers." You know, and I guess there are a couple of ways you could look at this. Paul's coming, so you kind of have to do what he wants. It's going to be really awkward if he returns and Onesimus is, you know, punished or even dead. That would just, you know, that'd be awkward. But I really think that Paul's just saying, "I miss you, and I want to see you again." And it's also really neat that he expects Philemon to be praying for him. And he also expects Philemon's prayers to be answered, because that's the kind of faith Philemon has. His prayers are answered. In verse 23 and 24, we find these final greetings. "Epaphras, my fellow prisoner in Christ Jesus, sends you greetings." Epaphras was also a part of the Colossian church. It seems like he's with Paul at this time. Maybe that's how Onesimus and Paul meet. Epaphras is out running errands or doing something for Paul. And, you know, Onesimus just happens to run away to the city where Paul is, runs into Epaphras. Epaphras recognizes him because he's from that same city where Philemon is. And so he introduces him to Paul. I don't know, that's just speculation. But and Epaphras sends his greetings, as do Mark, Aristarchus, Demas, and Luke, my fellow workers. Paul is always saying, "These guys are my partners. These are my fellow workers." It's not Paul the apostle and then all other Christians. It's we're all in this together. We're all servants together. And he ends with, "The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit." And that's a verse that I constantly overlook in all of Paul's letters, because that's just how he ends his letters. It's like his, you know, his little tag that he puts at the end of everything. But I think that verse sums up this letter perfectly, because that's what he wants Philemon to do, to be gracious towards Onesimus, just like Jesus was gracious to you. Philemon, you were a sinner when I met you. Philemon, you were going to hell when I met you. But not anymore, because God had grace on you. And you need to bestow that same kind of grace on Onesimus. And so as we enter 2016, I hope that that kind of tagline would define your year. That the grace of the Lord Jesus would be with you. Because our world needs grace, and not the kind of grace that where it's okay to do anything that you want and it's just going to be okay. Not the kind of grace where you just, you know, tolerate everything and nothing really matters, but the kind of grace that changes people's life, like it changed Philemon's life and Paul's life and Onesimus's life. I've been reading a book by a pastor, a speaker, an author named Francis Chan on marriage. And in this book, he admits that he and his wife will get into arguments and fights. And he said that if he, you know, if he were to look back and be honest, that a lot of times, you know, the arguments would escalate into fights because he just wanted to be right. And he says maybe the most important thing isn't being right. And you know, if I look at my marriage with Ashley, I know there are times when I just want to be right, and it, you know, it, I mean, it causes an issue sometimes. But maybe the most important thing isn't being right. And in this, you know, this story, Philemon is in the right. He has every right he wants to treat Onesimus however he wants, to receive him back however he wants. But the most important thing isn't being right. And Paul knows that. And Paul's a guy who debated at the Areopagus, where, you know, the most learned and educated and the smartest people from all around would come and in Athens gather at this place and debate. And Paul was there debating. And Paul says the most important thing isn't to be right. And our world, our world needs grace. And sometimes I worry about our world, and I just I worry about my kids and what's the world going to be like that they grow up in, and when they're adults, what's the world going to be like? Because I know that our world is confused right now, and you know, it's hard to see an absolute right in the sense of what our culture perceives as right, or does our culture even perceive right and wrong sometimes. And I mean, I know that I could look at statistics and things that show how crime has escalated over the past few decades as a rejection of God has increased, and I could, I mean, I feel like I could make logical arguments for the need for God and the morality that a belief in God would instill within people. But I know that at the same time, you know, words aren't going to change this world. It would be like if I were to try to teach a physics lesson. I don't know anything about physics, but if I did, and I know this because I looked it up, but Newton's law of force says that force equals mass times acceleration. And I've said that and you're already bored, because that's what physics is, if all it is formulas. But if I show you a rocket ship being blasted into the sky, you're thinking, hey, that's cool. And someone says that happens because of physics. And, you know, I wonder, why didn't God just make things, why didn't he just absolutely give us proof of his existence or something like that? And maybe it's because like a formula like that is just boring and it's not going to attract anyone. But a lifestyle, you see things, what you can see, not necessarily what you can hear or what can be explained, what you can see, that's what people notice, and that's what changes people's lives. That's what changed Paul's life and Philemon's life and Onesimus' life. It's people being gracious with them. And so even though I could say these things are right, I know that it's more important to do right, and in that sense to have a yes face. I know that God has been gracious to me, and something that I need to remind myself, that grace has been bestowed upon me, and so I need to bestow grace upon others. And it might not be easy. It might not be, something I want to do. It might look strange. It might put me at odds with people. It might put me at odds with our culture. But I believe that that's what our world needs, and our world will see it when we start to, or when we do what's right, and when we say yes, when we demonstrate grace. because that's the power of grace. And so this year, I just may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. We're going to have a time of invitation this morning.